Good morning.
Good morning.
That's better. Thank you.
The St. Regis Parish Faith Community gathers for the liturgical celebration of the sixth Sunday in the season of Easter. We ask you to fully participate in the liturgy as a community by praying and singing together. There are two announcements. All mothers, daughters, grandmothers, granddaughters should check their schedules for next Sunday, the 9:30 a.m. Mass for Mother's Day, to sing in the mother-daughter choir. We have one practice a half hour before the Mass, that's Sunday at 9 a.m. Please consider singing in the mother-daughter choir next Sunday, Mother's Day, at the 9:30 a.m. Mass. Also, please note that next week from 8 a.m. to 11 a.m., the Knights of Columbus are having their special Mother's Day pancake breakfast, Seton Hall, downstairs. Treat your wife, mom, or grandmother to a beautiful breakfast of eggs, sausage, orange juice, and coffee. That's next Sunday, Knights Breakfast, 8 a.m. to 11 a.m.
Thank you.
Okay, now that we have seen our first communion class process in, we're about ready to get started. So I'm going to ask all of us to, once again, good morning. Good morning to all of our visitors. And let's take a moment to stand and welcome each other in the peace of Jesus Christ. You already heard my instructions earlier before the youngsters came in, so you know I want everyone participating. Let's all grab one of the hymnals that are in our pew racks and turn to 573, All You on Earth. 573, please join in our opening hymn singing. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each of you. Amen. As we come together to begin our prayer, we are reminded that each of us is sinners in need of God's mercy. And so we pause for a few moments as we acknowledge our failures before the Lord, letting Him know those times when we were not Christ-like or loving with one another. And as we ask His forgiveness for those times, we give Him thanks for the gift of His mercy and love. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us all to everlasting life. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory, Lord God. the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us, for you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, and the glory of God forever.
Let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, that we may celebrate with heartfelt devotion these days of joy, which we keep in honor of the risen Lord, and that what we relive in remembrance, we may always hold to in what we do. And we ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Revelation. With the help of the Spirit, the angel took me to the top of a very high mountain. There he showed me the holy city of Jerusalem, coming down from God in heaven. The glory of God made the city bright. It was dazzling and crystal clear, like a precious jasper stone. The city had a high and thick wall with 12 gates, and each one of them was guarded by an angel. On each of the gates was written the name of one of the 12 tribes of Israel. Three of these gates were on the east, three were on the north, three more were on the south, and the other three were on the west. The city was built on 12 foundation stones. On each of the stones was written the name of one of the Lamb's 12 apostles. I did not see a temple there. The Lord God all-powerful and the Lamb were its temple. And the city did not need the sun or the moon. The glory of God was shining on it, and the Lamb was its light. The word of the Lord.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endures forever. Let the house of Israel say, his mercy endures forever. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad.
The hand of the Lord has struck with power. His right hand is exalted. I shall not die, but live on you, declare.
all works of the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day the Lord has made.
Brothers and sisters, may the Lord be with each of you. And now let us listen attentively to a reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said, "If anyone loves me, they will obey me. Then my Father will love them, and we will come to them and live in them. But anyone who doesn't love me won't obey me. What they have heard me say doesn't really come from me, but from the Father who sent me. I have told you these things while I am still with you, but the Holy Spirit will come and help you, because the Father will send the Spirit to take my place. The Spirit will teach you everything and will remind you of what I said while I was with you." The Gospel of the Lord. As has become my custom through the years, whenever there's a First Communion class, there's actually two instructions, one addressed to the adults and the parents of the youngsters, and then the second with the youngsters themselves. So the oldsters get to hear their talk first. I'm one of the oldsters, by the way. It had been 6 weeks since we celebrated Jesus' resurrection on that first Easter Sunday. But we know that the story did not end there. For the past 6 weeks, we have, in a sense, been walking with Jesus as we have been listening to the stories out of the Bible. And later this week, we will be celebrating a special day that we know as Ascension Thursday, a day that commemorates Jesus being taken up into heaven to sit at the right hand of his Father and our Father. His ascension, in a sense, I guess you could say, marked the end of his earthly life. However, as we have been reminded throughout all of John's gospel, Jesus tells the apostles and us not to let our hearts be troubled. And he says that he will not leave us alone. He's not only present in the Eucharist that we receive and which the children will be receiving today for the first time. Jesus, God, is present in the Word of Scripture anytime we listen to it, anytime at home when we are reading it on our own. But Jesus is also present to us in the Holy Spirit that we receive, not only on the day of our baptism and confirmation, but also in a special way every time we celebrate Pentecost Sunday. And that's what the disciples were waiting for as Jesus was taken up into heaven. But before he was taken up, he was preparing them for that ascension, for his leaving them, for his departure. And as he was preparing them, they were beginning to talk among themselves, and they were being reluctant to hear that their teacher would leave them. And so Jesus, throughout those final days, is telling them, do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God. Have faith also in me. And he assures them that he would send that Holy Spirit to be with them until the end of time. A few days later, as he is taken from their sight, he does what he instructed them to do. They begin to pray. They return back to the upper room, and they begin their praying, and they prayed for 9 days, waiting for that special gift that Jesus would send them. And on that Pentecost Sunday, their prayers were answered. The Holy Spirit descended upon them. That Spirit strengthened them and sent them out into the world to boldly proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ and how much love and care the Father has for each and every one of us. Now, through it all, they were confused. None of them had any kind of formal education. Few of them had some minor education, you could say. But because of the Holy Spirit, they go out to the four corners of the world, as Jesus told them to do, and they begin to build what we now know as the church. You and I are members of that church. It was begun by Jesus, and his message was spread by the apostles and the other disciples. We are now the modern-day disciples. And at times, we may deny Jesus, as did Peter. At times, we may doubt his existence, as did Thomas. At times, we may wish that Jesus would rain fire down upon our enemies, as did James and John. And at times, like all the apostles, we are scared. We're afraid. We don't know what to do. And so how does Jesus respond to our human weakness in those moments of fear? He responds the same way to us as he did to the apostles. He responds with love. He loves us and he never abandons us. And each of us is a beloved disciple in his eyes. And he fills us with the grace of the same Spirit that he gave to his 12 apostles and disciples. Now the church, because it is human, continues to struggle, continues to experience scandals, to be persecuted. But because of the grace that comes from the Holy Spirit, the church continues to grow and flourish, even with all the problems that come with it. Today, in a very special way, May the 1st, is the feast of St. Joseph the Worker. Because it's on a Sunday, the readings for 6th Sunday of Easter take precedence. And I do have an article in a bulletin about St. Joseph the Worker. But briefly, as God worked for 6 days during the creation of the world, he has entrusted you and me the marvelous privilege of being a co-worker with him. Jesus was born into a family of ordinary people, working class like you and me. And as such, he learned the trade of his dad, which we know is carpentry. As for you and me, whether we are students or already in the workforce, whether we build a workbench, a dining room table, or a cathedral, whether we make a gourmet meal or a simple meatloaf and potatoes supper, whether we manage a large farm or just put in a small backyard garden, each of us and everything that we do is blessed by God, just as he smiled and looked on the 6 days of his creation and said, "It is good." And so today I want all of us to be reminded of whatever we do, be proud of it. It is important in a part of creation that God has entrusted to each and every one of us. And one of the greatest things any one of us can do along with God and the Trinity is to work with them in spreading the message of the gospel. You parents who are here and grandparents and maybe some of the godparents are here from their baptism, you have been entrusted with a special responsibility with the children that God has given to each of you. You asked for your children, he answered your prayers, and now part of the responsibility is raising them in the Christian and Catholic faith. Today is a very special day with their first communion, but believe it or not, every Sunday is a special day, to bring them to church and to celebrate with their parish family here as we join together every week in prayer. And every day at home is special as you wake them up for school and you take the time to go over the morning prayers with them. In the evening, I remember when we would get home from school when I was a kid, and Dad would be at the coal mine, Mom and Grandma would be in one of the rooms doing their quilting, and they would take turns with us, going over the religion questions for the next day's classes, going over the spelling questions, going over some of the adding and subtraction questions. Parents were very active with us when we were growing up. And before we went to sleep, one of the last things they did is made sure that they would be there with us whenever we did our night prayers. It's a sad thing whenever people come to the confessional and don't know how to pray the Hail Mary or the Our Father. And that can only go back to one source, the home. The family that prays together stays together. It's an old saying, but it's a true one. It goes back several thousand years, that saying. The family that prays together stays together. And so parents, grandparents, godparents, I am strongly encouraging all of us to take an active role. I thank you for what you've done to bring your kids to this point thus far. You've done a lot of work working with Stephanie and, there you are, Laurie. Who's Laurie? Stephanie, who's Laurie? I keep calling her Laurie. Why do I do that? Huh?
Kindergarten.
I'm sorry. But anyhow, I mean this very seriously. I know there will be some parents who are offended that I'm talking this way, but it's important because if I don't do this, then I'm not doing my job for what I was ordained to do. Each of us has been called to do something to spread the message of the gospel. I do my share, but I cannot do it all. Stephanie and Colleen do their share, but they cannot do it all. Well, you can in your family because you're there. But enjoy today with your kids. And as I said, remember, every Sunday is a celebration of the Lord's resurrection. Every Sunday is a celebration when we gather together as a Christian Catholic parish family to not only pray to the Lord, but to thank Him for everything He does for us. One of the names that we give to Holy Communion is what? The Eucharist. And the word Eucharist comes from the Greek language, which means who remembers?
Thanksgiving.
That's exactly right. And so one of the things that we should do every day is to thank God for everything He does for us, the many ways He shares His love with us through our children, through our health, through our employment, through our friends and neighbors. Prayer is very important. And now, youngsters, here and there, who wants to answer the first question? Your little brother. If you want to answer the first question, what is the first question? You don't know it. Okay. First communion class. And parents, you can whisper in their ears if they're a little bit nervous and give them the answer, okay? First communion class. What are you here for today? Yes. Communion. And what is communion? I don't waste time. I move fast. Go ahead. That's when we get Jesus' body and blood. And are we actually eating His flesh? Or how do we? What's it look like when we get it? Bread and wine. But we know that whenever we receive it, because of the special prayers at the altar, it looks like bread, it looks like wine, but it no longer is, right? Okay. Why is receiving communion important for any of us here? Again, I'm still asking the first communion class. Why is it so special, and why do you think it's important to receive Holy Communion? I mean, we're all dressed up real special, so that means something important's going on here. Why is receiving communion so important and special?
Yeah.
Because it gets, I like that answer. It gets us closer to Jesus. Is that what you said? Yeah. Receiving communion gets us closer to Jesus. And how's it get us closer to Jesus? I'm going to mess with Karen now and hide behind the pillar. Okay. How does it get us closer to Jesus? Okay, I'll ask the rest of the congregation. How does receiving communion get us closer to Jesus? His body and his blood are now becoming a part of our body, and his love is coming into us and showing us how to be loving people with one another. Right? Yeah. Yeah. So, how many of you are loving people? Is that just for the... Okay, now we got it. Now we got it. Okay. Hands down. Now I feel like that mother of sorrows when I'm doing the school math. Hands up, hands down. Okay, if we are all, how many of us never sinned? That's good to see, because you'd be surprised when I'm in a confessional how many times people say, "Bless me, Father, I've sinned. It's been, geez, I can't remember, Father, 5 years, 10 years, but I can't remember a thing I've done wrong in those 10 years. Ooh. Okay, yeah, we're all sinners in need of God's mercy. And that's what John has been telling us throughout this Easter season about God's love for each and every one of us. First Communion class, do you believe that Jesus loves you? Somebody say yes. First Communion class, let's try that again. Now you sounded like your parents earlier. Let's try this again. First Communion class only. How many of you believe that Jesus loves you? Say yes. Okay. Parents of the First Communion class, how many of you believe that Jesus loves you?
Yes.
And how, the rest of us, do we believe that Jesus loves us?
Yes.
We're getting them there. It's taken me 4 years, but we're getting them there to respond. Okay. I always like to do this with the kids. And I'm going to do it again today, because I'm still on schedule. Do the youngsters have any questions for me? Do you have any questions that you would ever want to ask a priest but never had the opportunity? Go ahead now. Go ahead. No questions. That means you know everything. Oh, wow. Okay. All right, so what we're going to do today is we're going to receive our first communion, very special. Jesus' body and blood is going to become a part of our lives. And as he comes into our body, he nourishes us, just like the Twinkies we had for breakfast or the Cheerios and milk that we had for breakfast. Just as that nourishes our body, Jesus' communion nourishes our mind and our heart and our soul. And as it nourishes us, it teaches us how we should live lives of love for one another. It teaches us the way Jesus cared for the people back then and how he still cares for us today. It teaches us how we need to be caring people for one another, how we need to be nice in the on the playground and in the school cafeteria and at homes with our brothers and sisters and parents. So kids, I'm happy to have you all here today. This is a pretty good sized class this year. I like it. And Stephanie texted me the other day because I was away last week, and she says, "We're a little bit concerned about the seating and what we should do." And I says, "We'll just snuggle up a little bit closer and learn how to love each other." And she did then what she's doing now. She just smiled at my answer. So, kids, are you excited? Good. I'm not going to hold you up any longer. Let's take a moment now. We're going to stand and make our profession of faith. And instead of doing the one that we typically do, the Nicene Creed, we're going to do the one that I think all of us know whenever we begin the praying of the Rosary, the Apostles' Creed. Okay? So that way the kids will be able to participate a little bit easier. So let's take a moment to stand. And if you need to know where it's at in your book, it is the yellow tab. I think all of your books have these little tabs at the top. Go to the yellow tab, which is page 37. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray.
The response is, Lord, risen Lord, hear our prayer. For all members of the church, may we extend the gift of peace to others through our love and service to the glory of God. We pray to the Lord.
Risen Lord, hear our prayer.
For the leaders of nations, may their actions be guided by mercy and justice with respect for the dignity of all people. We pray to the Lord.
Risen Lord, hear our prayer.
For those in our parish who are seriously ill, may they feel God's presence by family, friends, and the compassionate care of medical professionals. We pray to the Lord.
Risen Lord, hear our prayer.
For our children who have come to receive First Communion, may their lives be changed and enriched by the sacrament of the body and blood of Christ. And may they be blessed in every way in their journey to God. We pray to the Lord.
Risen Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially Thomas Harder, whose funeral will be Tuesday, may they share eternal life in heaven with God. We pray to the Lord.
Risen Lord, hear our prayer.
For our loved ones who have died, and during this Mass, we remember in a particular way Walter Annemiek and the deceased members of St. Regis Parish, we pray to the Lord.
Risen Lord, hear our prayer.
For the prayers we hold deep in our hearts, which we now pause to add.
We pray.
Risen Lord, hear our prayer.
For the safety of our men and women in the armed services, we pray.
Risen Lord, hear our prayer.
And for those whom the Lord may be calling to serve as a priest, brother or sister, deacon, or other related ministry within the life of the church, that they be willing to follow the call of the Lord in a spirit of generosity, we pray.
Risen Lord, hear our prayer.
We thank you, Jesus, for this beautiful day and the love that you share with us in so many countless ways. We thank you also for the Eucharist that you share with us to strengthen us on our earthly journey, on our way to the kingdom that awaits each and every one of us. And we pray in a special way for our youngsters who will be receiving you in the Eucharist for the very first time today. Strengthen them, strengthen their families in their resolve to continue to hand on the faith as the apostles handed the faith on to each of us, so that through each of us, that faith may continue to countless generations until the end of time. We make this prayer in your holy name and united with the name of Mary. Amen. Amen.
The offertory hymn is number 640, Gift of Finest Wheat, number 640.
Finest Wheat.
Let us pray that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept this sacrifice. Our good and the good of all. O Lord, accept our prayers and offerings. Make us worthy of your sacraments of love by granting us your forgiveness. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Amen.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them up. And let us give thanks to the Lord our God. God our Father, you have brought us here together so that we can give you thanks and praise for all the wonderful things you have done in our lives. We thank you for all that is beautiful in the world and for the happiness that you have given to us. We praise you for daylight and for your word which lights up our minds. We praise you for the earth and for all the people who live on it and for our life which comes from you. We know that you are good, that you love us and do great things for us. And so together we join the angels and saints as we join in a hymn of praise. Father, you are always thinking about your people. You never forget any of us. You sent us your Son, Jesus, who gave his life for us and who came to save us. He cured sick people. He cared for those who were poor, and he wept with those who were sad. He forgave sinners and taught us to forgive each other. He loved everyone and showed us how to be kind. And he took children in his arms and he blessed them. God, our Father, all over the world, your people are praising you. And so now we pray with the whole church, together with Francis, our Pope, Benedict, our Pope Emeritus, Edward, our Bishop, Lawrence, our retired Bishop, and all bishops, religious, and all the clergy. In heaven, the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. Joseph, her spouse, St. Regis, the apostles, the martyrs, and all the saints are always singing your praise. God, our Father, you are most holy, and we want to show you that we are grateful. We bring you bread and wine and ask you to send your Holy Spirit to make these gifts, the body and the blood of Jesus, your Son. Then we can offer to you what you have given to us. On the night before he died, Jesus was having supper with his apostles. He took bread from the table and he gave you thanks and praise. And then he broke the bread and gave it to his friends, saying to them, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." When the supper was ended, Jesus took the chalice that was filled with wine. He thanked you, and he gave it to his friends, saying to them, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant. It will be shed for you and for all so that sins may be forgiven." And then he said to them, "Do this in memory of me." We do now what Jesus told us to do. We remember his death and his resurrection, and we offer you, Father, the bread that gives us life and the cup that saves us. Jesus brings us to you. Welcome us as you welcome him. And together, let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Father, because you love us, you invite us to come to your table. Fill us with the joy of the Holy Spirit as we receive the body and blood of your Son. And Lord, you never forget any of your children, and we ask you to take care of those we love and for those who have died. Remember everyone who is suffering from pain or sorrow. Remember Christians everywhere and all other people in the world. We are filled with wonder and praise when we see what you do for us through Jesus, your Son. And so we sing, through him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen, amen, amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we have the opportunity now to pray in the words that Jesus. A little bit closer. We're going to hold hands. Go ahead. Don't be afraid to touch the girl's hands. Couple more. There you got it. Okay. Where was I? Oh, at the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we now pray in the words that Jesus gives to us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, O Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus the Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give to you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's take the time to move around and share his peace with one another. Peace be with you, and peace be with you, and you, and peace be with you, and you, and you, and you. And you can go to your folks now. Okay, peace be with you, and you, and you, and you can go to your folks now. Okay, go back with your families. Peace be with you. Thank you. Good job. Thank you.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us.
Behold, this truly is Jesus. Behold, this is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. How blessed are those who are invited to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof. Only say the word and my soul shall be.
The communion hymn is number 660, Take and Eat, number 660.
Thank you.
sets the captive free. I am the life that raises up the dead. I am your peace, true peace, my gift to you. Take and eat, this is my body, given.
Sweetness and our hope. To thee do we cry for banished children of Eve. To thee do we send up our sighs, mourning and weeping in this valley of tears. Turn then, O most gracious advocate, thine eyes of mercy towards us. And after this our exile, show unto us the blessed fruit of thy womb, Jesus. O clement, O loving, O sweet Virgin, pray for us, O holy Mother of God. Saint Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our defense against the wickedness and the snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the Heavenly Hosts, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and all the other evil spirits who prowl about the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Just a reminder, as I mentioned during the homily, this coming Thursday is a holy day of obligations for Catholics. Mass schedule is Wednesday evening, the vigil, at 7 p.m., and Thursday, the holy day itself, at 7:30, not 8 o'clock, 7:30 a.m. in the morning. So do check that out. And speaking of the bulletin, when you get your bulletin this week, check out the new format, okay? Because of our sponsors, we were able to get an extra page in there, which means we're no longer cramming the print so small that you need a magnifying glass to read some of the items that are in there. So the print's a little bit larger, and what we want you to do is check out who the sponsors are. A lot of the sponsors on here are our parishioners. Whenever you see them, do like that bird that's singing out there. Sing their praise that they are helping us out with their contributions to make this bulletin possible. That will mean a lot when they know that you saw their name on the back of the bulletin. And not only thank them, but if possible, help them out by making a purchase, if at all possible. So do check that out. And other than that, again, to our first communicants, thank you very much. You did a good job. Parents, again, you did a wonderful job. And as I mentioned earlier, not only today, but every Sunday, bring them to church with you so that they can celebrate how much God really loves them and loves each and every one of us. But as the apostles learned through the Holy Spirit, how each of us have been called by God and given that awesome responsibility of sharing God's love and care with one another. That's what it's all about in our baptism. To keep handing it on to future generations, because if we do not do our share, who will do it for us? God's trust depending on you and me to help him in the work of salvation. So this is what today is all about. They have been nourished, and now they are being sent forth. And I'm going to shut up because I don't know how else to end. Let's stand for our closing prayer and blessing. Almighty and ever-living God, who restores us to eternal life in the resurrection of Christ, increase in us, we pray, the fruits of this paschal sacrament, and pour into our hearts the strength of this saving food from heaven. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And now we bow our heads as we invoke the Lord's blessing. May the Lord bless us and keep us.
Amen.
May he let his face shine upon us and show us his mercy. And may he turn his countenance towards us and grant us his peace.
Amen.
Thank you. May the blessing of Almighty God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, come upon us and remain with us forever.
Amen.
Let us go in the peace of Christ, glorifying the Lord in the many ways we share his works with one another. Thanks be. Again, have a good week. Thank you.
The closing hymn is number 562, Jesus Christ is Risen Today, number 562.
Jesus Christ is risen today. To Christ our Heavenly King. Amen.